Future 2.0, I'm trying to touch the space, what is there in the future 2.0. Science is all about space and time. Now you look at the space, which is prowling around, which is probably would have found in the universe somewhere around 13 billion years back, 13.6 billion years back. Spilling around at this point of time, somewhere around 96 billion light years. That's what you're seeing here in the logarithmic scale. In a normal scale, it's very difficult to see then where we stand to show that at the keeping us middle in the Earth where we stand. So now we're looking space and time. What is our relation in the future? I think that's what I'm trying to travel you, unravel you for next 18 minutes or so. Now you're looking at this, the evolution of the man over the time. As many speakers already touched upon, even few thousand years back, the man is started growling, and now he is tempting towards the computers, he is again leaning back. But even few hundred years back, would not have imagined, could not have predicted the future of what we are there. Now, looking at here, at this point of time, in a space and time point of view, in the domain, where we will be. Maybe that thinking may be wild, we may be totally off, but still, looking at the statistics, how we have evolved, probably how we can go. I think there is nothing wrong in thinking about that. So today's thought is just to think about that, but trying to bring in Eureka moment, every one of you, wherever you stand, whatever you do, even the previous innovator, I think there is a very good possibility in the space and time in the future is coming, how it's going to be there. Let us unravel what my thinking point of view at this point of time. You look at here, this is the typical way of predicting people will talk about. Future, how you predict. Okay, the linear growth leads to somewhere else. But something happens during the time frame. It takes you somewhere in flux. That influx takes you just a little different where. But you cannot later going there, I didn't expect to be here. But if it happens to be coming over here, what your readiness towards that and how you are going to equip with yourself over the time. I think this is the basic thing I'm trying to tell you. Which is the curve? Your path is taking, which is the curve humanity is taking today, which is the curve the space is taking us over the time. I think that's what we are trying to touch upon here. You look at here, just a year back of my birth coming to this Earth, 1957, I born 1958. A small, tiny Sputnik has gone to the space. And my 60th year when I'm celebrating, 61 year for the Sputnik, its replica exact model of that, I happen to be nearby that. Just a scaling point of its source. But by the time you can see around the globe, it is so many space objects have come. It's a very, very tiny system to start with Sputnik. Just to show humanity can put a artificial satellite to starting with that. Now the satellites is part and parcel of everyone's life, whether you like it or not. Like Earth, your air you are breathing, similarly, your satellites are pervading you in various domains. And this around the Earth today, how many satellites are around? Just you're looking at here, that itself shows how the progress has come from 57 to 2018, very fast it has come. Where India stands, when you're starting here, where we stand today, and how we are playing also part of, you look in here. This is 1982, the year I joined ISRO, where we used to make one or two satellites every 3 to 4 years. Now you look at here how steeply that is happening. Just in the near future, immediate past itself, we have done nearly 10 to 12 satellites per year. Okay, gone are the every 4 years making one satellite, every 4 months you are making satellite. The satellites of today, capability is nearly 100 times, much superior than what we talked about initially. That the growth now, both quantity and quality has keep improving a lot. That means the trend itself shows how it's going to take off. But while talking about the missions, past, present, future, within ISRO, what is the manpower? You look at here, the manpower statistics talks about almost stagnant. That means people who are superannuating, they are getting compensated inside. Otherwise, almost a stagnant manpower. That means the present manpower, existing manpower by number, still has to manage for the increased quantity and quality of the satellites. How it can be happen? I think that's where the management aspects came into picture. Beyond that, looking at the way in which ISRO has done, ISRO is faring well. Prime Minister of India called for, see, all the 70 departments gets both the central and the state government, and they are trying to ask for them. You imagine what sort of things you expect from each one of the departments, be it as tourism, forestry, fishery, many, whatever thing. Each one of them think about what satellite can provide for them. A lot of thinking has given. And a two-day seminar to start with, what satellites capable. And from there, they think their own way of satellites can required for that, has been asked for that. And wine marketing numbers came. That means that to start with, next couple of years, 85 spacecrafts, various domains, be it communication, remote sensing, oceanography, atmosphere, cartographic studies, or scientific studies, you have to first make so many satellites. The satellites of different nature. The satellites should be done in much faster way, much cheaper way. I think this is another quantum jump came here. How to do it? This lesson probably will help us to extrapolate probably what is happening, what's going to happen in the future. Now we're looking back here, keeping ISRO in center, we spread it out. That means we brought in industry to come part and parcel of ISRO's effort. This gone are the days, it is within the classrooms of ISRO's to be done. That means spread out there. Good number of industries, academia, were brought in under the umbrella of ISRO, and we are able to make that many satellites, keeping the same number of people within ISRO. That means outsourcing activity of rocket technology also possible. I think that's what we ensured that. And having done that, industry also ready to do that. The vibrant industry, we are able to enable them and bring the people to under the umbrella, and we are able to make that commitments. And today you look at here, last 3 to 4 years, almost every month one launch of the satellite happening, thanks to this participation of ISRO and industry participation. That's helped in a lot way. Now we're looking back here, coming back to the cow, where we are standing. To start with, ISRO is to have self-sufficiency for remote sensing and communication satellites to meet our own needs. But now you're going to look at here, we have gone a little different curve. That means today we're talking about going for a moon, Mars, manned mission, governance. That means the government of India and state governments have been asked, and we are trying to use in a much, much bigger way the satellite technology, so that the last penny can reach to the common man which much faster way. The visibility and monitoring can be done much better way. So this brought out a mind-boggling numbers, mind-boggling technologies coming in a space. Okay, that means like God is seeing you or not, satellite is seeing you, how the satellite money is being spent there. I think that's the umbrella in which it's happening there. So when that comes, already you can see that original, the linear curve expected versus already you're taking a slightly different curve. So now what is going to happen in future? I think that's what thinking is concerned. The parallel run, you look at here, to put the cost, that means the every kg to put the thing into an orbit, how much money we are spending to start with versus how it's happening here, a steep decrease has come here. So this putting together, the requirement is going up, but whereas to go there, the cost is keep coming down. The volume number, commercially putting the things together, it's possible to put the market point of view, you're able to put the here. So that means industry can come in much, much, much better way. It's happening there, the world of space is concerned. Now we're looking at here, looking all the things, putting the things together, possible space point of view, future 2.0. Originally, it is as from the space, using the satellites for communication, remote sensing, and possibly to make it faster, as I told here, make it faster every month, every like that, making it better. The satellites would work in a much better way, and it would be cheaper also. I think this almost we have done it. Having done it now, satellites need not be bigger. The smaller satellite, that's also already on the anvil. And totally different newer applications. What satellite can do today, and a lot of innovative thinking, as previous speaker has told, very, very innovative thing, what's happening here, similar thing is happening. Indian space scientists are trying to do very good things happening in the newer applications also coming there. That is for from the space to the earth. Then another umbrella is go to the space, then into the space you're looking at there. That means put the satellite will look into the space and try to unravel some of the newer mysteries. And for that, probably space station can be there. But today we talk about a totally different concept of international lunar space. That means existing space station, if it goes its own time over, life limited system over, future, let us not build a new international space station around Earth. Let us make it around Earth using the moon as a space. And for that, India playing a key role, especially after the discovery of water on the moon, the way in which you have done, it is not discovery alone, the way in which you have done probably will give a good leadership position for India. Down the line you will come to know. So this is the another step we are talking about. Beyond that, travel into the through space, not only using the space for our purpose, not only going to the moon and travel into the space, very much feasible. That is to starting with, I think, unmanned missions may keep going, but probably in the years to come, manned mission, we are already started, elsewhere also going there, manned missions will go, and over that, like our goods train we are talking about, ferry missions to the moon or Mars, already habitat, assuming habitat is there, to supply them, supply missions. In the whatever we talk about national highway, I expect a super space highway is going to happen there. And for that, a good number of activities will happen. Haven't done everything there. In a moon or Mars, and days are not far, wherein we are supposed to make moon or Mars conducive to how we can live with. Okay? Beyond that, it should be done there. Towards that, a lot more has to be done. What is required habitat there? Food, water, self-sufficiency happening there. Very many things. I think this is what Eureka moment. Eureka moment not only for the space scientists for space travel, in assuming there is a locality, their new colony is coming, space colonies in the moon and Mars, what possible avenues, every one of them, including the innovator, there is a good scope can be done what is there. I think that is the Eureka moment I'm talking about here. That means future 2.0, like looking back, road travels we have done, starting from how we walk through our wheels have come, many things happened there, road travels have come, sea expeditions, very tough or not, now I think they are able to do it reasonably well, and air travels also, to start with the science, but now today it is now no longer a science, no longer a technology, it is a pure instrument which enables us to travel. That's what, with that only we are able to connect globally. Now we talk about global city. Cities are not very much demarked by the distance. Because of these things, we are able to connect there. Days are not far. Where space travel will enable Moon and Mars as a habitat. And that means you have the Australia, you have US, you have Antarctica, you have Europe. Probably could have separated by geographical distance. But when space travel comes, even Moon and Mars is not going to very much different from you. That is another colony for the human. I think that's how next step going to come before future 3.0 comes, which will go much beyond what I told there. So that means to start with Moon and Mars as a habitat is very much not very far there. That means putting the things together. To start with, that travels, space, all the travels will happen keeping Earth, Moon and Mars as a living planet. Okay? It is no longer Asia alone, no longer Europe alone, no longer America alone. Now, yes, all the continents are connected because of the safe travels in terms of road and sea, air. Space will be able to bring in Moon and Mars also together, enabling as a big umbrella. So that means we are no longer an isolated entity, Earth alone, Moon and Mars to start with. Future can unravel much better way. And this is what I expect. I think many places, many where people are putting there's a space can be there. But farther to self, you have to keep going and coming. But you can be living there in a longer life, doing some other things which you are not able to do it here. Okay, which polluted atmosphere, it's a very good gravity, things together, some of the things which are not possible to do here, can be done there here and be brought, possibly we can do. Yeah, very pollution-free nuclear energy is very much feasible, keeping moon as a resource place is very much feasible, experiments going on, connecting these things will help. That means that travel to that place will be much faster, travel to that place will be safe. I think that's what we are talking about. So this is what I'm talking about, a corridor, that is our space routes. After this, I go for the national highway to go to Chennai. But now this is a place to go to come there. That means from Earth to Mars, Mars to Earth. Okay? It is a two-way communication. Already one-way communication people have registered. You know that. I had 2 hours spent with them. Now this is we're talking about two-way of travel going to the Mars, going to the back, coming to the East concern. Days are not far. And the recent development indicates the people in a space, possibility of their age can be slightly better than the age, whatever our getting aged in Earth is another revelation. That means you have two twins. The twins, one is kept here, another one is taken to the space. And after long stay there, brought back, when trying to analyze them this way, and it has seen that his immunity power, the person who was there longer stay in immunity power has improved than the person who already sitting here, indicating the possibility of longer life. more than 100 plus in space is possible. That means putting together good number of people going for the space also coming. So this space route will come there. That means now all put together, it is Earth, Moon and Mars as a living planet. Living planet, no longer we're talking about Earth, that's happened there. But for that, safe route, safe sea, safe air and safe space is going to be the corner of the day. Who will do this? Okay, this is not a phenomenon, this one talking about here. Who is going to do this? And to start with, this can be major players who can dip into that, to that is point of view. NASA, European Space Agency, ISRO, JAXA, Japanese Space Agency, CNSS, Chinese, they are prominent players, they can do it. How they are going to do it? Are they going to do it alone? I think it can be different. This is where our Chandrayaan model has come into picture. Before Chandrayaan, nearly 70 missions gone to the moon by US, by Russia, by Europe. Many people have gone, China, Japan also have gone. Still India's only mission which has gone with international participation. It's a unique mission to discover water on the moon unambiguously. So that success story, why can't replicate here? I think that's what we're talking about here. That means, I told you, Graf, wherein ISRO being there, industry partners helped us for us to improve a much better way. Similarly, the model is a slightly better way. Bringing Moon and Mars together in our living planet, bring other umbrella also. NASA, ESA, JAXA also in our umbrella. So that says that you go for a common goal, not individually going there. That means a common presence built there, common wisdom builds there and go there. That means about ISRO, good number of industries. Along with NASA, good number of industries, similarly ESA and GNSA. You look at here, same thing was sitting there. Along with the JAXA, along with the NASA, JPL, Brown University, universities and NAVAR were sitting there. Similarly, along with ESA, we have Max Planck Institute, University of Bergen, to the Laboratory, were there. So a model was existing. That success model has been very well acknowledged worldwide. Now putting together, I propose this model there. And this proposal is not here. I'm telling you, this already we have done. I had a chance of chairing a UN committee of outer space for quite long, 3 years, and put forward this objective, and this has been taken very well. Okay, that means to start with going for the moon, as I told about lunar space, let us not talk about International Space Station artificially, let us make use of the lunar space, let us go commonly together, let us build the things together, people have taken very, very appreciatively, that probably this will be able to go there. That means, while talking about all these things, it comes parallelly other way. So you look at here, a student who started his schooling in a very, very cow shed, in a place in Tamil Nadu called Kodavadi, and his ambition was not higher, anything better than the higher school teacher. Okay, but today he is standing here because he has taken another cow. Because fortunately he happened to ISRO, and ISRO took him away, up and up, and no longer I am seeing a saturation today. Even though I am telling about my own case here. To start with, it was only dreaming about Moon and Mars. Today we are not talking about dreaming about Moon and Mars. We are talking about a finite target. India is taking a lead there, very much feasible. Because of the positions, whatever happened there, because the way in which I had traveled there, because the way in which ISRO traveled, I part and parcel of that, I feel very much, this is a very much feasible thing. And you look at here, how the humanity has improved. I think almost similar, Kodavadi to Bangalore, when I'm standing here, almost travel is similar. But putting the things together, individual, an organization, globally, all the things putting together, I believe this space, Future Food 2.0, definitely gives us an opportunity to unravel much better way, go wider, go faster, go better, connect the things together. Very much visible, today's humanity needs, which way. Beyond that, when we are trying to talk about globally, all these 4 or 5 top players going in tandem together, it will bring in a peace, lot more peace to the earth. With that, I complete. Thank you very much.